Goes back to the emperor is naked. No one wanted to tell the emperor that. Anytime you're in power, no one wants to tell you that you're naked, you know? And there's a lot of people walking without clothes these days and need to be told that sometimes, you know? That's all you can do. Like, from my point of view, I just wanted to have fun and do that. And if people are upset about it, I don't know, maybe I did my job, I don't know.
You know, smart, funny, edgy people in there, and then when people stand up and they're smart, funny, and edgy, then they all whack their heart.
Well, by the way, it's not everybody. Many of the journalists had a great sense of humor about it. You know, it's not like everyone's upset, you know. Don Lemon flipped me off during it after and said, that was great. I said, motherfucker, you flipped me off. But he was very nice, you know, about it. And, you know, some of the other people. It's just, you know, there's people like that. You can go anywhere and find people that are going to be like that, though.
But I mean, the point is, a lot of people thought you were really good, but you got a lot of criticism, too.
Sure, that's fine.
But when you, some people, I mean, people are like, you know, they said, one line about me was, he looked like he was sired out of a love scene in a film, Deliverance.
Once again, are they wrong, dude? We're keeping it up and good.
All the stuff that during the impeachment, the thing that they said.
Right.
But what I really don't know to you, and you're not a powerful guy, so you're like, what is it about some people, not all, that attain a level of influence and power that believe that they shouldn't be criticized or mocked or made fun of? That if you're smart enough to get there, then you're smart enough to know what comes with it.
Yeah, I think more court jesters were probably executed than they ended up living long. I mean, who knows? It's not easy for anybody to take criticism, but I think the more shielded you are, the more you're in a bubble, the more you're protected, you know, by people around you who say yes all the time, the harder it is to hear no or those types of things. I think it really is human nature and as simple as that.
I have to ask you this.
Sure.
81% Trump support believe that prejudice against white people is a bigger problem than prejudice against. I understand. But what is it about? Maybe you can help me understand somebody's mindset. And a lot of people think that. Somebody's mindset that thinks that. Or somebody like you that reads that. What do you have to say to that? I'll find it.
James, you're a white guy who grew up in the South. You should be telling me.
I had a pretty good gig.
Yeah. Now, you guys had a fucking awesome gig. Absolutely.
Yeah. Going on third base, you didn't even get in trouble.
Well, look, most of the Trump stuff is cognitive dissonance, you know, all the time. I don't know why people think that. I mean, they're following a guy who thinks the president is a secret Muslim, you know? I mean, like, how are you gonna sneak praying to Allah 5 times a day? I don't even know how that works, you know? Oop, drop my contact. No, I got it.
The Obamas are model powers. And they just kind of hang there. So now we can agree on that. Okay.
Yes.
Now maybe you disagree with
me. No, I think they are.
But they are the best powers that I mean, literally.
Sure.
I just find that really disarms the really vehement critics. If you just come back and just say that and then say, now, if you were saying about socialized medicine, okay, well, I'll give you the. I know this is a broad question and not an easy one, but why not? What is the one thing in your close astute observer, what is the one thing about politics in the United States that you wish would change, that you think could change as a opposed to?
I wish we would break up this two-party political system. It is a thing that is called gerrymandering, which is a byproduct of it, and so you keep getting the same people in the office who are entrenched on extreme sides of their parties because that's how they keep getting elected. If we could have 3, 4, maybe 5 parties, I don't know, mix it up a little bit, share the governing between people with disparate ideas, I think there could be a real good movement for actually 2 different types of centrist parties, a center-right and a center-left party that could have some really good political clout if people really join forces on it. But I think people are tired of nothing getting done. And a lot of them, yeah. And it is because people are so entrenched. When your ideology is not to pass certain legislation, but it's to make sure someone doesn't get elected, you can go fuck yourself as far as I'm concerned. You don't belong in office. You don't belong in office. You know what? When it comes to the election, that's when you should be electioneering, to make up a word, you know. But when you're governing, govern. Get something done. What happened to being collegial and working with the other side? You know, you can say your rhetoric or whatever, but get something done. That's what you're there for. So I think let's break it up. Let's have several political parties. I think that would be good.
Yeah,
and then there'd be places for people like Bernie Sanders, you know, people who don't quite fit neatly in the political parties. I don't even know if Hillary Clinton would be a Democrat.
My own view is I think that our arguments have become apocalyptic. Mm-hmm. And that there is no, and I tell my students this all the time, there's no public policy that is 100% good. The closest I can come to it, and I've thought about it for a long time, is taking lead out of paint. But somebody made a living in the lead. Somebody broke it, sold it, double-minded.
So people made money in the slave trade too.
The research now is that it was an unbelievably profitable enterprise.
Of course it was.
Yeah, it was. And but everything.
And by the way, the problem in Flint was done for an economic reason. They were trying to save money.
Clean water costs money. But some things are, it's close to 100 to nothing. But you know, when every argument tends to be made, if not now, when, if not who, us, we stand on the precipice. The choice is prosperity or death. Which side are you on?
Yes, I know.
No, that's a hard choice.
Yeah, I know. All right, prosperity, I guess.
So you think that we need more choice in America?
Completely. I mean, look at the Republican Party, how much they have to contort themselves and twist themselves into these red meat politics during their primaries. It is hilarious. As a comedian, it's enjoyable. As an American citizen, it is not. When you see people who might otherwise be reasonable have to take these positions, and, you know, it happens on both sides, too. It's insane, you know.
Why, and everybody feels this way, why is it getting worse? Why do we feel like it's moving away from us? Did we do something? Did they do something? Did something happen in the world? What is driving this?
Which part?
The fact that it seems like we people talk at each other, not to each other. There's a lack of collegiality in politics. There are apocalyptic arguments being made. Why now?
Well, people started, at least in this last, let's say, 25-year cycle, and I'm sure it's happened before. I always say, look, let's not act like politics just got corrupt. Caesar was stabbed on the Senate floor, right? So it's been corrupt for a long time, right? But it does, I think it goes in cycles where it checks and rechecks. But certainly in the last, let's say, post-Bork cycle, it seems to me that politics has gotten more into the politics of destruction of character, you know, and of people rather than, you know, of ideas and policy. I'll never forget when Bill Clinton was elected and hearing on the radio, this is when Rush Limbaugh was just in his infancy and starting to get really listened to. And I listened to everything. I try to spread the dial and that type of thing. And I remember him making horrible jokes about Hillary Clinton. And the way that she was treated in those, and I'll never forget, those first few months. I mean, horrible jokes, nasty jokes, not even funny. I mean, just, you know, just, I can't even repeat some of the things. And I thought, this is terrible. And the way that the Clintons were treated during that period, you know, not that they were saints or anything, but I thought the way that they were treated was completely different than I had seen before. Because even the Reagan jokes, I thought, were kind of, you know, jovial jokes. The jokes against Carter, same thing. You know, they never seem personal, really, in that sense. They seem personal at the Clintons.
Can I take a point of personal reference?
I mean, you were there.
I was not there. They tried to overturn a goddamn election on a matter of consensual sex. That's what they tried to do. And you know who they were that was called? Bob Livingston, Henry Hyde, Newt Gingrich, Dan Burton, Denny Hassett, Kim Starr. Kim Starr was outraged at an act of consensual sex. Yet when he was president of Baylor, and they were having breakfast recruiting for the football team that could help him win, he went the other way.
I love those face changes when he gets in
the water. Yeah, we got a few minutes of protocol here. We'll take a couple of questions from the audience, but if you're going to give a speech, I'm going to cut you off. If a question to Larry, you can frame cogently for him to answer, raise your hand, and I'll call him. Okay, yes, sir.
Sure, you bet. Well, no, I know what you're saying. I mean, we're not really a democracy, right? We're a representative democracy. And I think there's value in that. We just have to probably vote for the right representatives. I mean, look, England's going through that right now. There was no reason why Cameron had to make that vote a referendum. You know, he was facing pressure from his own people, the conservatives. And it's like, be careful when you let the people vote on something. Like if Obama just let the Americans vote on whether or not he was a secret Muslim. No, Obama, no! Don't let America vote on that! You know? Or say, hey, let's let America vote whether we should have a wall to keep up. Like, no, don't let America vote for that! No, we'll vote for people who will make the decision. So I hear what you're saying, you know, it feels like that. I believe that direct voting really is at its most powerful on the local level. You know, and you probably agree with that, where a lot of changes can happen at the local level and branch out, you know. But at the federal level, it's hard enough to get anything done, but, you know, God help us, direct voting if we did right now. I wouldn't even know what to think of that. But, you know, you never know. We could be wrong.
I think that their system is a pretty, you lose. Yeah. The parliament, you're out that night. You don't have a transition period. The new prime minister sleeps at number 10 ballots that very night.
Right.
And they have sort of party, and if they wanted to go, somebody wanted to, the time to do it as an election, to sort of heat of the moment, you make a decision like that. I think Cameron is justifiably getting slaughtered in this thing. Mm-hmm. I think that's a good reason for it. Anybody, a quick question?
Yes, sir,
please.
I think Obama's exit is probably the first thing. For some reason, they don't want to work with that man. I don't understand it. People say a lot of different reasons. I'll let you have your own. I'm hoping if Clinton is the next president that she can get them to work. I don't know. Trump, I have no idea what would happen. God help us if he becomes president. Maybe Congress will come together to save us from President Trump. He said if Hillary's elected,
the Republicans ever allow her.
Oh yeah, they have to at this point.